Morning.
Morning.
I always want to say morning, but it's afternoon. But we're glad that you're here as we celebrate another day, as we see what God has in store for us. It's been a nice warm week, and then all of a sudden we have turned into a colder day. But there's good news in sight, if the weather men know what they're talking about. But as my dad wrote a poem for me when I was in sixth grade, but to the weatherman I won't go, for surely he's not in the know. So we'll see how well they know, but all forecast models are showing that tomorrow and Tuesday are our best chance of some rain, and boy, do we need it. Be nice to have some green grass. I don't enjoy mowing a whole lot because of my allergies, but hey, I'll get out there and mow because it's wet and green, and it makes the flowers grow. So what are we thankful for this week?
The rain we got last night.
Y'all got rain?
Yep, got rain on.
Y'all got rain?
That must be nice. So what did it look like? Was it like clear? Was it colored?
It was kind of dark.
I was up to 1:30 this morning. We got wind, but that was all we got. But like I said, we're supposed to get some more rain. It's supposed to be scattered today and widespread over the next couple of days. So let's hope for that. What else are we thankful for this week? That your mom's doing good. That's always a great thing. Thankful that it wasn't a stroke that my mom had. That's about the only thing we know for sure. And we got some answers on some other things that was like, okay, now where do we go from here? Like one of our friends said, you go to the doctor with this problem and you find out that that's not the problem, and here's a whole list of other things that you didn't know that you had that you now have. So, gotta love the medical system, but we would be lost without them. So we are thankful for the medical personnel. What else are we thankful for this week?
My hours are picking up a little bit.
So more hours, that's always a good thing, because the more hours you get, the more money you make. The more money you make, the easier it is to pay your bills. We're not going to worry about whether or not we have gas or eggs, but at least we can pay our bills.
It's one of our today.
Yes, we do have a good group. And it's always nice to look out and see everybody. We were sitting here before the service, and I was looking, and I said, well, when I was talking to my mom, I said, well, it's just us here right now, so it may be like it was before and just record to nobody, but y'all are here, and then everybody gets it online to see as well. So it's kind of last minute, and so we're just going to do like we've done before, and we're just going to sing out and just enjoy. And we're even singing an old hymn today, so we'll see how that goes. So if you're ready, let's get started today.
How all our longings have been
if you didn't get it from the first two songs, we're kind of talking about praise today. And what better way to praise the God who gives and takes away, the God who provides for all of our needs, than to going to Him in prayer. Because prayer, it's transformation. It brings
revival,
healing, and forgiveness. And we have a lot in our church that are hurting. We have a lot that are sick. We have a lot that need healing. We have a lot that, because let's be honest, every day that we wake up, by the time we go to bed that night, we need something to be forgiven for. Because last time I checked, none of y'all were perfect. And I get reminded on a daily basis that I'm not perfect either. Most of the time, it's every time I look in the mirror, like, yeah, there ain't nothing perfect about you, child. So let's go to God in prayer as we think about those that are hurting, those that are sick. God, we thank You that You love us. We thank You that You hear us when we call. We do praise Your name. For You are holy and You are the only one who can answer us when we call. We thank You that You're not deaf to our cries for help and our cries on behalf of others. You know the ones that we have in our church and those online that are hurting and dealing with situations in their life. We ask that You be the comforter and the healer and the great physician to them. Let them know that they're not alone. They're not forgotten. But they are loved, not just by You, but by us as well. For those that are hurting and sick, we ask for restoration and healing. May doctors, may the medicine that they take, may it be a way to make them feel better so that they can be productive, so that they can be in Your house with Your family. For those that have experienced loss, we ask that You be with those and to comfort them. Their hearts. For those that are dealing with family situations, just ask that You be the great reconciler and restore family situations. When there seems like there's no hope, there's always You. We pray for our country, for our leaders, in a time where it seems the most important thing is to be divisive. And there's seeds of discord everywhere. May we be the ones who shine Your light of truth and love and peace. Be with our military, our first responders, as You protect them. Be with their families as they're separated, and give them protection. Be with our church, that You would allow us to be a light to the world, and that it would shine bright with the truth of Your word, that You love us, that You want us, and that You gave us Your Son to make that a reality. Thank You for the service that we can come and to sing Your praises and to hear Your word. In Your name we pray. Amen. Let us stand as we sing our final song as Lennon comes to do our tithes and our offerings.
Shadows deepen.
We do.
you know that all the dark won't stop the light from getting through? Do you wish that you could see it all, maybe?
He is standing through in the Lamb of God.
That because it asks the question, is he worthy? And that's where we're going today with our message as we pick up in Ephesians chapter 1. We're going to kind of go back over one verse that we did last week in verse 3 of chapter 1. But my question to you is, who are you worshiping today? What do the names Michael Jordan, Tiger Woods, LeBron James, Tom Brady, and Stephen Curry all have in common? Basketball or sports? Okay. What about these? Do they kind of have the same thing in common? Babe Ruth, Kim Kardashian, Channing Tatum, Taylor Swift, and Beyonce. They all have the same thing in common as the first group. People worship the ground they walk on. And they think they're just the best thing in the world. I mean, people will wait in line for days to get tickets to some of these concerts. When Taylor Swift started her new tour, it broke Ticketmaster. And there's still a huge lawsuit because people lost out on money in getting into see a concert because so many people were flooding to get tickets. You have people that will camp out for days before the season tickets go on sale for their favorite sports team. But here's the thing. You can cheer all you want to at that concert. You can sing as loud as you want to at that concert. It'd be great to see them. You can go to the sporting event and you can yell your head off, but at the end of the day, they don't know who you are. Last month, we had the opportunity to go see the Collinsworth family again. We'd talked to them before or after the concert. I've talked to them a couple of times online, but you know, when we saw them, they acted like they didn't know who I was. And we had, probably an hour and a half conversation the first time with them after the concert. Then we saw them after this concert, and we talked to them for a while afterwards about their family and everything. And you know what? Those rude people didn't even invite us onto their bus. Me and Cherie have our picture taken with the governor and the lieutenant governor of this state. But I can guarantee you, neither one of us can walk up and pat him on the back and say, "Hey, Greg or
Dan.
Hey, Dan, how's it going?" And go into their private area of the house and just sit back and watch football or baseball or spend the night. It don't work that way. But you have people that will idolize and worship these people. Some are like, well, no, I don't do anything like that, but we worship something else. What are we always chasing? That almighty dollar, that paycheck. Sometimes we live paycheck to paycheck, but that doesn't mean we have to worship it. Exactly. Give me my money. It's my money. I want it now. Some people are worried about getting that next fish, that next high, sinking that next putt, or having the best or most popular reputation every single day we go through life, looking and trying and worshiping something or someone. It's just who we are. I'll ask this question again at the end of the message, but who are you worshiping today? Because see, every day we have a choice to make on who we are going to worship. Last week we started out and Paul told us in the first three verses who our identity is. We are not what the world says we are. We're a whole lot more than what the world says we are. Sure, we may be kooky, we may be quacks, we may be freaks in their eyes, but that's okay. I can handle that if it means that I'm following Christ and what He wants for me. I'll be a quack and I'll be a freak. Because at the end of this life, when my eyes close, if Christ hasn't come back, I'm okay being a freak to this world if I hear those words, "Well done, my child." Who will be the freak then? We found out that we were saints and we're called for something, and we're continuing this blueprint for life as we go through the book of Ephesians. Because Paul lays out a step-by-step blueprint of how to have a happy and a successful life here on this earth. And today is no exception. We concluded with verse 3 last week because it tied into that study. Today, we're starting with verse 3 because it ties into this one. And if you look closely, verses 3 through 14... it's basically one long breath. Because he starts praising God. And then he's praising, and he just automatically starts going right into it. He doesn't take a breath. He doesn't stop. He doesn't get something to eat. He doesn't get something to drink. He just keeps on going, and it flows right into, "I'm praising Jesus Christ. And I'm praising. Oh, and now I'm praising the Holy Spirit." It's one long, continuous deal. And it's, as one pastor refers to it, it's the doxology of praise to the Trinity. Because you see God, you see the Son, and you see the Holy Spirit. So if you're ready, let's look together. Ephesians chapter 1, verses 3 through 6. The first part of this beautiful passage. "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, even as He chose us in Him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before Him. In love, He predestined us for adoption as sons through Jesus Christ, according to the purpose of His will, to the praise of His glorious grace with which He has blessed us in the beloved." That's a long praise. And he starts out by praising God. And let's be honest, what better place to start a praise than with God Himself? Because when you got up this morning, who gave you the ability get out of bed? Was it your parents? Was it your spouse? Was it a family member? Was it a pet? Your little pet goldfish? Did he help you get out of bed? Was it your vehicle? Was it your home? Was it you? You had the ability to get out of bed because God gave you the strength. God gave you the breath to have the strength to get out of bed. The older we get, we realize that's not always the case. Some days it's hard to get enough breath to get out of bed, to get through the day. But we can still praise Him. Notice verse 3, we praise God because He has blessed us with all spiritual things. We saw that last week, that everything that we have because God gave them to us. But then he goes a step farther and says, God chose us. You didn't choose God. God chose us. So this just gets even better from what we saw last week. Not only does God make us saints, He chooses you and me. You. I mean, look at you. The one who can't even stop sneezing over here. Even you He chose. You that has a headache. You who doesn't feel good. You who can't stop making mistakes. You who keeps falling down all the time. You He chose. And just so you don't think I'm picking on you, He chose me too. The one who, like Dad says a lot of times, has that foot and mouth disease, gets foot stuck in the mouth before the brain got engaged. Even me too. He chose you, me, in our weakness, in our sinful state. You and me in a place when we weren't even worth anything. You, me, He chose us. When He chose us, He did something else. It wasn't just chosen. It's not eeny, meeny, miny, mo. It's He chose us. But it wasn't Paul doing the choosing. It wasn't some ruler. It was, we are chosen by God Himself. Think back to when you're on the playground at school and you're picking teams. How many of you were the first one that always got picked? Everybody wanted you on their team. I'm not saying no hands. I was always the one, well, I get stuck with you again. I'm the ones, they would pick the ant or the ladybug or the mouse going across the playground rather than picking me. I was the one that if we were playing basketball, you stay right here under the goal. We'll throw it to you. You give it back to us, and we'll score. Don't even try to shoot. I'm the one that was always last. I was the one, just so that we didn't have any problems, they would break their arms when we're playing Red Rover just so I couldn't come over. Go through life not ever being chosen. And then find out, didn't matter if the world rejected you. God Himself chose you and me. Now that alone should make us want to praise Him. But here's where it even gets better. We're not just chosen by God, but we're chosen before the foundation of the world. So I want you to get this, because this is really good, and I have it in my notes, and I want to make sure I got this, because when it came to me Friday night, I was getting all excited typing this up. So I want to make sure I get this right. Before Genesis 1:1 ever took place, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth, before any of that ever took place, God chose you and me. Do you realize what that means? That before He even created Adam and Eve, you and I were chosen by God. before the animals and the birds and the fish and the ocean and the trees and the mountains and the stars and the moon and the sun, before any of that was created, He chose you and me. Before He even sat there and said, let there be a ball of a mass, the verse 2 says that, and there was darkness over the void. Before any of that ever took place, you and I were chosen by the Most High God. When was the last time Kim Kardashian did something good like that for us? Before anything was, God chose you and God chose me. But for what? Sure, it's great that He chose us, but what? It tells us that we were chosen to be holy and blameless. If you remember last week, we talked about a saint was someone who was set aside and chosen. Here again, He's saying the same thing. Holy simply means to be set apart. So you are a saint that is set apart to be wholly set apart. So we're doubly set apart by God Himself so that we can do something. I'm not sure what. But what are we set apart for? We talked about China last week. That you got your special dishes when the special company comes over that you got to wash to get them clean because they hadn't been touched in about 10 years. You set it out and you serve it when the best company comes over. It's set aside for special occasions. I'm not eating a peanut butter and jelly sandwich on my finest china. I didn't spend all that money for that. That's what the paper plates are for. But God tells us in this passage that before anything was, God chose you and me to be set apart, to be made holy, to be made blameless. And we'll get to that blameless again in a little bit. And we are set apart for Himself. God chose you and me to be set apart for Himself. Meaning that we are chosen by God so we no longer belong to anyone or anything else. So when Satan comes to us, you remember when you did that? You know, God can't love you for that. You're just worthless. No, no, no. It says before anything was made, God set me apart for Himself, which means I belong to Him. Now that is something to be worshipful for. And when we come to Him, He makes us holy, but also blameless, meaning we don't have a single mistake in our name. But God doesn't even stop there. Notice what He does from there. It says that He adopted us. That means that He wants us. He didn't just choose us, but He wants us. Imagine. This big, powerful God that all He had to do is speak, and everything that is. The God that all He had to do was say the word, and a third of heaven fell because of Lucifer's rebellion. The one who created the angels that sit there and worship Him 24/7. This is the same God who wants us. You chose. As far as I know, nobody wanted to be born. that's in this room, right? You didn't come to your parents in a dream and say, I want to be born, so please let me be born. We didn't do that. We didn't choose to be born. But it's amazing what happens when you see a baby. I don't like kids. I don't want to be around kids, and you see a baby.
I want to hold them.
I want to get that baby juices, the baby fever. But see, the thing with adoption that makes it so much better than natural born. Natural born, you're stuck with them. You birthed them, you stuck with them. But out of adoption, you're not stuck with them. I can look all over this country or any other country and choose which one I want. They now have it where you can even go and look at the embryos and see, is there any type of malfunction? Is there a history in the lineage where there may be some type of mental defect or physical defect? Because we want a perfect child. They even have money back refunds on implantations if the child comes out with some type of defect. Last time I checked, God was not in the defect business. He likes taking defects and making them perfect. Meaning, the defects that you and I have in our lives, we got plenty of them, let's just own up to it. God still said, I want and I choose them. And when we become adopted by law, and this is anywhere in the world, that this is a law, that when you are legally adopted, you are now entitled to every legal inheritance. So whatever belongs to the ones that adopted you, you are now legally entitled to. Meaning that once you are adopted, whatever your new parents have, that when they die, you are legally entitled to inherit. Which means everything that is God's, when He adopts us, belongs to us. So let's summarize what we've seen so far. We're called saints. We're chosen before God, before He ever created this earth. We're set apart as His personal treasure. We're made so that we are without any blame. And we're adopted with a new Father who loves us and wants to be near us. I don't know about you. That's certainly enough for me to praise Him and sing this song to Him, praising our God, that God is so good. God is so good. God is so good. He's so good to me, to you. But Paul doesn't stop there. He just keeps right on going, praising God, praising God, praising God. And look what he picks right up with in verse 7. Verse 7, in Him, talking about Jesus, we have redemption through His blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of His grace, which He lavished upon us in all wisdom and insight, making known to us the mystery of His will, according to His purpose, which He set forth in Christ, as a plan for the fullness of time, to unite all things in Him, things in heaven and things on earth. In him we have obtained an inheritance, having been predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things according to the counsel of his will, so that we who were the first to hope in Christ might be the praise of his glory.
I like that.
Paul tells us that we are to praise the Son. What better reason do we need to have to praise him than what it says in verse 7, that we in him we have the redemption through his blood. We have been forgiven because of Christ. He shed his blood for us so that everything that we have done wrong just washes away. Even though we are filthy, the scripture says that when we are in Christ, we are washed, and though our sins be as scarlet, we'll be white as snow. I'm not ready for snow, but it sure is pretty, that first snow, and you look out, nothing's been on it, it's shimmering, it's shining, and it's clean, and it wipes everything away. It's all dead and dirt and mud and dead grass and sticks and stones and rocks all underneath that snow, but you don't see it. It's nice and beautiful. It's kind of like when you're flying and you see the tops of the clouds. You just want to walk out of the plane and just lay out on a cloud. Don't do it, you fall. Somebody came up with the idea of having gravity. If Newton wouldn't have done that. But notice why we have received this forgiveness and redemption. It wasn't because of anything that we did. We received this because of the riches of the grace of Jesus. Jesus' grace gave it to us. It's because of him. Not only are we recipients, but the mystery of God's will was made known to us through Christ. And what was his will? It was to set a timeline to unite all things in Christ, whether things here or things in heaven. And then verse 11 takes us back to what we saw in the previous section, that we have obtained an inheritance because we were predestined. Predestined's a big old word. A lot of people get so upset and bent out of shape over predestination, or do we get to choose, or free will. Predestined simply means to be chosen. I don't want a God who can't make up his mind. I don't want to serve a Savior who can't choose me. Sure, we have the free will to reject him. But he knows ahead of time whether or not we will. But he still loves us and lets us choose. There it is. It's because he chose us that we have that. Because we've been adopted, we have the inheritance. But what is that inheritance? It's a place with God forever. There is no separation. There is no getting away. And what is this place? It's a place that has no need of stars, or moon, or a sun, because the Son of God is the light. It's a place where streets are made from the purest gold ever found, so pure it looks like glass. There's 12 gates around the city, and each gate is one pearl. One big old pearl makes up one gate. Take that, Home Shopping Network. The foundation is made up of the most beautiful, precious stones that has ever been thought of. Take that, JTV. It's a place where our loved ones who have died and are enjoying life are now at. It's a place that was made for the saints. And what makes this inheritance even better than all of that? Ready for it? I'm glad you're sitting down. you're watching, sit down before you fall out on this. What makes this inheritance even better than all of that beauty that we see? It never ends. It never changes. It can never be taken away from us. And it will never be boring. Heaven is not a boring place. How could it be? We get to be in the very presence of Jesus who saved our soul. But if that doesn't encourage you to praise the name of Jesus, because we put our hope and trust in Him, we are the praise of Christ. So we're praising Him, but He's praising us because of what His grace did for us. No wonder we can say Jesus Messiah, name above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, God with us, the rescue for sinners, the ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah, my Lord of all. Which brings us to our final point. Two verses. And man, do these two verses pack a punch. Verses 13 and 14. In Him, talking about the Holy Spirit, you also, when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and believed in Him, you were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until we acquire possession of it to the praise of His glory. Again, the praise of His glory. This is where it gets really good. Notice just what we get in verse 13. The truth, which is the good news of salvation. No fake news here. It's 100% factual truth. God loves you. God sent His Son to save you. And if you accept Him and you believe in Him, which is the only way to get to heaven, you get in the door of heaven. But that's not the end of it. Because when we have believed in the gospel, in Him who it talks about, then it says that we are sealed by the Holy Spirit. First glance, it may not seem that big of a deal. But that seal changes everything for us. It makes a world of a difference. Here's how it makes a difference. Follow along with me on this. A few years ago, my mom planted a garden. And boy, was it a garden. It just kept on blooming. It kept on growing. There are times that she couldn't get out there fast enough to pick everything. And it was, you have zucchini one day. If you didn't pick it by the next day, it was this big. I wish I was exaggerating. No, I'm not. She had, if it wouldn't have been for the freeze that came in the middle of December, she would have still had tomatoes on the vine in December. I don't know what happened that year, but that was an amazing deal. She had so many vegetables, she couldn't freeze it all. She couldn't even give it away. Because everybody was getting all that they could, but there's only so much you can hold. So she did what any good woman does, any good planter does, any good gardener does. She canned them. She had to Google to find out how to can, because that was her first time to do a garden. And so they, her and her friend canned. Have you ever canned vegetables before? It's not that difficult of a process, but there's a few things that are crucial in order to can. First thing, you have to have the vegetables. You don't have any produce. You don't have any fruit. You don't have anything to can. Other thing you got to have in order to can. Most important ingredient in the canning process. A jar. If you don't have the produce, you don't have a jar, you can't can. You're just cooking. But even though it's really good, even though you grew it, you know what's on it, what's the first thing you do before you put the produce in the can, in the jar?
You wash it.
You wash it with?
Water.
Water. Remember these steps, because they'll be crucial in a second. Once you do that, then you put it in the jar. Then the jar gets put into a pressure cooker. Oh, and you put water in the jar too. Sorry, we got that one. You have water in the jar too. So it's cleaned and then it's got water in there. You don't want dried out canned vegetables. That's just nasty. And then you seal the jar. But one of the things that helps seal it is the pressure cooker. And, you know, I always loved getting the jars, loved being the first one to open a jar. Sit there. And then, you know, once you pop, it still kind of has a little bend. I'll just sit there. Pop, 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 pop. Sorry, I got distracted there. Bring back childhood memories. But, you know, if you can something, as long as it is still sealed, stuff will last for a long time. But if you pop that seal, you better hurry up and eat. Because it goes bad really quick. Landon made hot sauce a couple of years ago. And I opened mine. I was eating it away. I let it sit for a little bit in the refrigerator. Shut tight like I'm supposed to. Went back a couple of weeks later. I had about this much left in there. I opened it up. My wife would be happy. Because there's a nice little science experiment. Because there was stuff growing in there. Black, green, white. Other colors. And so I was like, okay, no. We're not going to do that. But as long as it's sealed shut, it stays good. But in order for us to get to that process, something had to happen in the garden. Didn't just put the seeds or just put the plants out there and walk away and be done. You had to water it. You had to fertilize it. You had to tend to it and watch it grow. Here's how all of that ties in to this message. Someone had to water the seed that was planted in us. We didn't just wake up one day and started becoming a believer in Christ. Somebody had to tell us about Christ. Somebody else came along and told us some more about Christ. Fertilizer. We start reading God's word for ourselves, not just taking somebody's word for what the Bible says. We start growing and we start pulling the weeds out of our life. Now it's time for us to get into the big part. We're pulled. We're ready to go. When we accept Christ as our Savior, we're washed clean from the dirt in our lives. We see that every time that we have a baptism. We are washed clean. The water doesn't save us. It's water. There's nothing special about it. Trust me. If it sits there long enough, it will smell. If it sits there long enough with nobody in it, nobody's ever been in it, it will smell. When the water heater works, comes down the water line into the water heater. Tim can explain all the mechanics of that, where it heats up, and then it goes into the baptistry and through a little faucet that we turn on, and it comes out. There's no magic power to it. It's the same water that's in a bathtub. If you really want to get technical, it's the same water that's in your toilet. So say it ain't anything special about that water. But it washes us clean. We're washed clean by the blood of Jesus. And then, just like the vegetables, we are put in a jar. The hands of God Himself. Just like with the fruit and veggies that we put in, you have to put liquid with it. Because if not, you shrivel up, and nobody wants that. So what would be that that's inside of the jar? Our jar. Remember, it says that when we accept Christ, Christ lives in us. What happens to the liquid that is inside of a canned jar of green beans? It floats all around the green beans. And you know, green beans have the little hollow center where the pea is. But that pea is not so big that it blocks everything. So the fluid that's in the jar floats through the green bean. He is in us and flows around and through us. And then we're put into the pressure cooker because, you know, life happens. Boy, do we get tossed and turned and shooken up. But because we are in the jar of God's hands, we don't break. If you do it properly, you can can a whole lot of jars at one time. Glass jars. And yet they don't break. As they sit there and shake it. Why? Because the jar protects it. Pressure may build on the outside, but it's safe and secure on the inside because of the lid. Nothing spills out. Because we're in the safety of the hands of God, we can feel secure. But we forgot something. We got the jar, we got the pressure cooker, we got the liquid inside. We put a lid on it so we don't spew out everywhere while we're being shook up. But we forgot one important part. The seal. Because we wasted all our time and all our effort if that jar is not sealed. And that's where the Holy Spirit comes in. Once we accept Christ as our Savior, we don't have to wait. We're not only adopted, we're not only given an inheritance, but we're also given the Holy Spirit at that exact moment. And when we receive the Holy Spirit, it says that He comes in and seals us. I love this. We received a seal and it keeps us together. When we accept Christ, we're placed in the hands of the God, of our God, the jar, which is filled with His blood moving in and around us, the water. When the storms of life, the pressure cooker, come our way, we're able to remain safe because of the blood and the hands of God, which remain intact, and we come out nice and clean and pure and undefiled. But if we don't have the seal, we will rot because life gets in our way. Verse 14 says that the Holy Spirit is our guarantee. that guarantee means our down payment. But a down payment for what? For our inheritance. Remember, as long as that jar is sealed, the contents are still good and they're preserved. The seal keeps it preserved. And unless you're ready to consume the contents of the jar, you don't open it. The Holy Spirit seals us and does not break that seal until it is ready for us to take possession of our inheritance. So when do we get to take possession of our inheritance? One of two ways. We close our eyes on this earth in death and wake up to a glorious, transformed life and body in the presence of God Himself. That's one way. The only way that we will not experience that, the way this world is going, I sure hope it comes soon, is when Christ returns and raptures the church out. It's the only two options we have. Until that moment, we are sealed until it's time. And we are firmly intact. I don't know about you, but that's worth celebrating. Because as long as we're sealed, the fluid of the blood of Christ can move through us, cleansing us, purifying us, and making us new. So it should be easy for us to praise the Holy Spirit and say, Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on me. Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on me. Melt me. Mold me. Feel me. Use me. Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on me. So as we close this morning, let me ask you a few questions. Have any of the people that I mentioned at the very beginning of this message, Kim Kardashian, Michael Jordan, Beyonce, Tom Brady, have any of them done any of this that Paul describes in verses 3 through 14? Has any of them done what God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit has done for you? Has any of them done anything? No? Okay. Keep that thought. Have they even come close? No? Okay. So if they haven't come close, then why do we praise and worship them and not God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit? I asked the question at the beginning, and I told you I was going to ask it at the end. Who are you worshiping today? Because see, here's the thing. As a believer, when you put your hope and your trust and your faith in Christ, you don't just get what we saw in the first section with God. You don't just get what's in the second section with the Son. You don't get just what's in the third section of the Holy Spirit. You don't pick and choose. You get all three. It's like on Let's Make a Deal. You won the grand prize, which was all of it. Not just behind this curtain. You get all the other two prizes too. You get everything that for Ephesians chapter 1, verses 3 through 14. We get it all. So who are you worshiping today? And if it's what we saw, may that be who we worship every day. So that way we can, with all the saints before us, sing out that doxology. Praise God from all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. God, we thank You. We praise You for what You have given us. Thank You for choosing us, for adopting us, for wanting us. Jesus, we praise You that You are our Redeemer and our Deliverer. May Your blood flow through us always, cleansing us and purifying us. We praise You, Holy Spirit, for Your seal upon us as You make us preserved until the day we stand before God. We praise You for what You have done and given to us. May we show You our appreciation by the way that we live our life. In Your name we pray. Amen. I hope you enjoyed that. It's going to get good next week as we dive into the rest of the passage and we get our first prayer out of this book. There's several prayers that are given in Ephesians, and we'll get to our first one next week, but we're so glad that you're here. Remember, there's always a place for you with us here or online. Make plans now to be here for a special Mother's Day service on the 14th, as we'll celebrate Mother's Day and enjoy each other, and y'all will have you moms will have a special treat, and us men get to enjoy, hopefully, y'all being nice to us on y'all's day, so that way we can be nice on our day. but that's not how it works. I read it somewhere. Just remember, moms are always right, and if mom ain't happy, nobody happy. But most importantly, we're glad that you're here. You're always welcome here. But most importantly, you are a saint. You're loved. You are wanted. You are chosen. You are sealed. Now go live like it and tell somebody else about it, and we'll see you next week.